Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Biology Addiction. This video is about cheese manufacturing, microbiology behind cheese and its spoilage. There are several videos on internet on cheese making, but I have tried to convey to all of you a little bit unique information about cheese. So let's get addicted together with the beauty of biology and never stop learning. If you are new here, please subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon. So starting from the introduction, at first we have to know what is cheese. Cheese is a fermented milk product, one of the oldest food, and there are approximately 2000 varieties of cheese worldwide. These cheeses can be categorized into several classes on the basis of milk utilized, such as cow, buffalo, goat or sheep, on the basis of curd formation process, either using acids or rennet extract or combination of both. Here rennet is a complex set of enzymes produced from calf stomachs but now produced by genetically engineered microorganisms. Then on the basis of texture or hardness or water content, there are soft cheese, semi-soft, hard and very hard cheese. Based on the fat percentage, there are double cream cheese, cream, whole fat, fat, semi-fat and skim cheese. Moving to the cheese manufacturing, that specially consists of curd formation and ripening. All cheeses results from a lactic acid fermentation of milk, which results in coagulation of milk proteins and formation of curd. So this is the overall detailed process of cheese making. At first, prepared raw or pasteurized milk is mixed with the starter culture in a vat at 18 to 50 degrees centigrade. Starter culture may be lactic acid or propionic acid bacteria, molds such as Penicillium camemberti, Penicillium candidum, Penicillium roqueforti, red or yellow smearing cultures such as Bravibacterium linens with cocci and yeast. Then the milk coagulated into a soft semi-solid mass, that is the curd, is a crucial step in cheese production after lactic acid fermentation or by addition of rennet or other combination. The most common being combined acid and rennet treatment. Lactic acid fermentation helps in the production of sour milk cheese with a pH of 4.6 to 4.9, and using rennet helps in the formation in sweet milk cheese with a pH of 6.3 to 6.6. This protein gel is cut into cubes while being heated and is gently stirred. Additives include calcium salts used to improve protein coagulation and cheese texture, nitrates to inhibit anaerobic spore-forming microflora, and color pigments. The milk fat content is adjusted to a desired level, and when necessary, the protein content is also adjusted. The whey is then drained off, while the retained fat-containing curd is subjected to a firming process called cenuresis. The firming gets more intense as the mechanical input and applied temperature increased. Curd and whey separation is accomplished either by draining of the whey or by pressing of the curd while simultaneously molding it. New methods of cheese making aim at including the whey proteins in the curd instead of removing them with the whey. Apart from giving higher yields like 12 to 18%, this process helps to economize on wastewater costs or elaborate whey treatment. This picture shows the use of ultrafiltration steps as compared with conventional cheese making. Alternatively, conventionally produced whey can be concentrated by ultrafiltration and then added to the curd or milk, can be showered with starter culture or rennet addition and then concentrated by ultrafiltration. In case of unripened cheese, which may have a soft, gelatinous or grainy consistency, in the production of soft unripened cheese, first the whey is usually separated after showering. Grainy unripened cottage cheese is generally produced in continuously operated coagulators with special temperature regulation. After whey separation via a filter vent, the curd grain can be washed in a screw vat, cooled and dried via another drying vent. In case of ripened cheese, molded cheese mass is placed in a salt bath for some time dried and then left to ripen in air-conditioned room. Ripening or curing is dependent on cheese mass composition, particularly the water content, the microflora, and the external condition, such as temperature and humidity in the curing rooms. The ripening of soft cheese is processed inwards. So, in the early stages, there is a ripened rind that is hard outer and an unripe inner core. This non-uniform ripening is due to the high whey content, which causes increased formation of lactic acid and a pH drop at the start of ripening. In the rind, special molds that grow more favorably at higher pH values contribute to a pH increase by decarboxylating amino acids. Ripening in hard cheeses occurs uniformly throughout the whole cheese mass. Rind formation is the result of surface drying, so it can be avoided by packaging the cheese mass in suitable plastic foils before curing. The curing for soft cheeses may take place in several days, and for hard cheeses from several months to couple of years. This is the yield from 100 kg of milk. All cheese ingredients are degraded biochemically to varying extents during curing. Following the slides, here is some examples of reactions. Lactose of milk is degraded to lactic acid by homofermentation during cheese manufacturing. For example, in case of cheddar cheese, the pH drops from 6.55 to 5.15 from the addition of the starter culture to the end of mold pressing. In the presence of propionic acid bacteria, as in case of Emmental cheese, lactic acid is further converted to propionic acid and acetic acid and CO2. This is the overall propionic acid fermentation pathway. The crucial step in this is the reversible rearrangement of succinyl CoA into methyl malonyl CoA. This is the step. The catalysis is mediated by adenosyl B12, which is a coenzyme for transformation of general type. The mode and extent of milk fat degradation depend on the microflora involved in the cheese ripening. In most types of cheese, as little lipolysis as possible is a prerequisite for good aroma. Exceptions are varieties like Roquefort, Gorgonzola, and Stilton. There are characterized by a marked degradation of fat. Lipolysis is strongly enhanced by homogenization of the milk. The release of fatty acids, especially those that affect cheese aroma, depend on the specificity of the lipases. Molds, particularly Penicillium roqueforti, utilize beta-ketoacyl CoA deacylase, that is thiohydrolase, and beta-ketoacid decarboxylase to provide the compounds typical for the aroma of semi-soft cheeses. Example, the blue vein cheese, that is Roquefort, Stilton, Gorgonzola. Protein degradation to amino acids occurs through peptides as intermediary products. Depending on the cheese variety, 20-40% of casein is transformed into soluble protein derivatives, of which 5-15 are amino acids. A pH range of 3-6 is optimum for the activity of peptidases from Penicillium roqueforti. Proteolysis is strongly influenced by the water and salt content of the cheese. The amino acid content is 2.8-9% of the cheese solids of the amino acids released. Glutamic acid is of special importance of cheese taste. Ripening defects can produce bitter tasting peptides. The amino acids are transformed further in early stages of cheese ripening. At a lower pH, they are decarboxylated to amines. In latter stages, at a higher pH, oxidation reactions prevail. Proteolysis contributes not only to aroma formation, but it affects cheese texture. In over-ripening of soft cheese, proteolysis can proceed almost to liquefaction of the entire cheese mass. The progress of proteolysis can be followed by electrophoretic and chromatographic methods. So the proteolysis acts as an indicator of the degree of cheese ripening. The decarboxylation of amino acids leads to the biogenic amines. For For example, phenylethylamine from phenylalanine and so on. The content of those compounds can fluctuate greatly depending on the degree of ripening. Then, processed cheese. This can be manufactured by shredding the hard cheese and the heating to 75 to 95 degrees centigrade by adding 2 to 3% melting salts and other ingredients. Then, imitation or analogue cheese, made up of protein, fat, water and stabilizers by using the same technology of processed cheese. Moving to the spoilage of cheese, harder cheese with lower moisture contents have longer shelf lives than the shorter cheeses. Faults that can arise include the surface growth of molds, which produce discoloration effects, although there is little penetration of or attack on the cheese. Molds and yeast like species of penicillium that may cause green discoloration, cladosporium cause green to black and candida cause black discoloration are involved in these types of spoilage. However, the harder cheese have a wax coating or develop a rind, and this minimizes the problem. Film wrapped and vacuum packed cheeses should prevent fungal growth by excluding air. Bacterial spoilage of cheese is more common during the manufacture and ripening. If the pH is too high, pseudomonads will grow rapidly as contaminants, which causes sliminess. Gelsey cheese is a common problem and is caused by coliforms fermenting the lactose with the production of CO2. CO2 may also be produced by certain lactic acid bacteria and clostridia. The latter may be controlled by the incorporation of niacin, an antibiotic produced by certain strains of Streptococcus lactis in the cheese. This antibiotic is particularly active against clostridia in cheese with a higher pH. Various flavor defects like bitterness and rancidity can occur in cheese caused by heat resistance like pieces produced by pseudomonas. The suitable strata culture and proper conversion of all the lactose to lactic acid is necessary for optimal flavor. Unfortunately, fudge attack to the strata culture may result in diminished acid production and other enzymes functions may hamper. Fudge contamination in raw milk and in whey may occur if high standards of plant cleaning are not maintained. In spite of having beneficial aspects of lactic acid bacteria to human and animal health, some of them are also associated with human illness. Several species of leukonostoc, pediococci, enterococci, etc. are involved in this. The enterococci are the third leading cause of nosocomial infections. That are hospital-acquired infections, with Enterococcus faecalis, Enterococcus faecicum being the two most common species. So that's all about cheese. The PDF of my overall lecture has given in the description box. Hope you like it. Hope this is informative to you. Please subscribe my channel and hit the bell.